the door of your hope. If there is no cross, then there is no resurrection. If there is no resurrection, then there is no resurrection of your life. If there is no cross, then there is no crucifixion. If there is no crucifixion, there is no sacrifice for sin. How then will you face a holy God on the day of judgment if there is no substitution for your sin? But in the cross, we find an answer to our death. We find an answer to our sin. The two greatest questions that any person has ever asked. And both are answered in the greatest event that has ever occurred. You wear them around your neck. You put them on the top of steeples. You put them in rings. But has the cross really come to take up a place in your heart? Wonderful Savior, it is finished.
You're going to have to think about what I'm saying tonight. This is thoughtful and deliberate and important. How many are hearing me now whose minds are either a battlefield or a playground? If you've graduated from Playboy and Sports Illustrated and other kinds of worldly things that our minds love to fasten upon, they will, if you'll give them no other alternative, even fasten upon things spiritual and religious, so long as they can be occupied. I'm becoming conscious that far from God making us in His image, we are most of us guilty of making Him in our image. There's a kind of fancy and fantasy and projection that takes place in the minds of many saints. Though we use the name Jesus, probably every one of us have another variation on the same theme. We need desperately and urgently to know Him exactly as He is, radically and utterly. And I have a suspicion that He's nowhere presented as the reflection and the image of God more accurately than in His suffering and death. Without exception, if our Jesus is one other than that which was crucified, it's a self-serving Jesus which we have projected out of the fancies. It falls short of the Jesus crucified. If we knew the importance of Christ and Him crucified, we would clear the deck and not allow our minds to be a mishmash of all kinds of things until God has Himself established an understanding that is utterly fundamental to our faith and to our walk. Christ and Him crucified. I think that it's the answer to the kinds of vagaries and self-imaginings to which we are prone. To what degree are we just singing a song to a kind of a blurred image of our own making that serves our own vested self-interest? Is not the root of all of our ill the failure to radically apprehend God as He is? If there's any false image, it can only be corrected by knowing God as He is. How many countless thousands of religionists are there occupying pews on Sunday who have yet to come to that cry and to that revelation? Singing hymns, quoting scripture, but have not had the revelation of who that half piece of flesh on the cross was. I think that we have suffered enormously for the avoidance of the subject, because Because the cross itself is ruthless and absolute. It's an unswerving standard by which everything should be conformed and measured. And if it is absent, if it has been neglected, if some other hokey substitute has been put in its place, everything is going to be out of variance and out of whack. Which I believe is the case and the condition of modern Christianity tonight. The many Jesuses of today are soppy, sentimental, and self-serving, and a complete contradiction to the Christ who suffered and died. You're going to have to think about what I'm saying tonight. We are, most of us, guilty of making him in our image. The real and pathetic condition of the lives of many Christians and the woeful condition of the church, the enormous fascination of the world, and its influence on God's people, all testify to the fact that we have tragically avoided the cross of Jesus. Only the cross can effectually crucify the world from us and we from it. The world is too much with us. Nothing less than the cross can separate us from a world that is powerfully seductive, at enmity with God, and lying in the wicked one. Are we not rather a people like those of old who desire a king who would come down from the cross, and we will believe him, rather than be required or invited to join him on it? How many of us who talk about the cross really in our hearts desire that he come down from it?
Sirs, I perceive that this voyage will